Hello everyone, and finally welcome back to the Aftermath series. Let us waste no time at all and dive right into this week's episode of Critical Role. So one thing to think about as we go into this episode is that the Mighty Nine are level 7, and they have access to 4th level spells, and boy did they deliver! We got to see a little bit of 4th level action in the previous episode with Jester using Dimension Door, but in this one, my goodness, did those spells come in clutch. Two of them, notably being Counterspell and the Summon Demon that Forge showcased. And I'm actually surprised the Mighty Nine didn't really question him about this afterwards, but we'll get into a little bit more of the aftermath of that fight a bit later. The main thing that I want to touch on in this battle that happened, which was absolutely fantastic, by the way, is while the Mighty Nine have really come into their roles in the group as far as combat goes, it's really nice to take a second and just highlight how their personalities are showcased or tested in these sort of battles. You know, Bo doing her part in trying to deliver the journal to the Plank King and having to show patience for once, which was a very nice small character development, as we know that Ford and Bo are trying to check each other and make sure none of them go over the line again. And I feel like this was the real moment where Bo was tested, as she was told to wait for the other guard to return with the Plank King, and to all of our surprise, she waited. Until the fireball went off, and then she decided to, you know, I really need to go see the Plank King, and then they obliged. But still a very nice small change in how Bo is, because I'm pretty sure I would put money on it that the Bo that we met earlier in the campaign would 100% have told them to fuck off, and she would have won anyways. And we see classic Jester putting on the disguise self, trying to persuade others to believe in what she is saying. But what was really interesting and what stood out to me as like a big Jester trait is that after she dimension doored herself and Bo, she sort of had, there's a conflict within her. She was, you know, do I want to go help Bo deliver this? Or should I go help my friends? And she ultimately decided to go back, which I think is one of Jester's biggest personality traits, is that she knows she cares dearly about her friends and wants to make sure they're okay and that they're happy. And we've seen this several times, basically every episode. So it's no surprise there. But again, I just want to go through and highlight everyone's personalities showcasing in this fight. And then we have Ford, who used a rather interesting spell, the Summon Demon, which again wasn't really touched on by the rest of the Nine. But that's not what I want to point out. What I want to point out is several times in this fight, he used his real voice. We know he's slipped up every now and then, and we know that his sort of cowboy accent isn't really his voice, which we will touch on a bit later. And it's definitely something to take note of. And then of course we have Caduceus Clay being the chill furbolg that he is, sort of. In this very intense situation, he was still very cool, calm, and collected. And once again having those clutch, negating the nat 20s, doing a little bit of healing and doing his invisibility. Just classic Caduceus Clay. And then Yasha just brute forcing her way through everything, shrugging them off. An absolutely incredible display of strength that she's trying to escape the grasp of all of the guards and pirate crew, and not being as slippery as ever. I just imagine not just squeezing through and climbing over people and darting between their legs, just doing everything she can to evade all of the guards that are trying to capture her. And then when she finally was grappled, she refused to succumb to this, but unfortunately she eventually had to concede. But you know, she made mention that she doesn't want to go to prison again, which is interesting because obviously, people would probably not want to go back to prison, but because it seemed like she was so set on not wanting to go back and not wanting to be captured, I wonder if there's something that happened in prison that she hasn't told anyone yet. But once again, it looks like there's a little more to that little goblin than meets the eye. And then finally, the one who started this all, Caleb, with his wall of fire, expeditious retreat, almost dying, I guess, not really. I wasn't too worried about Caleb since he was away from the fight. I knew he would eventually get caught up too and people would be able to heal him, so I wasn't too worried about him. But then him standing up and then letting the fireball soar through the sky and explode above the ship. Just imagining that once again, just a very cinematic, awesome moment. And it was very appropriate that he was then stunned afterwards after suffering from his PTSD that he sometimes gets. 100% understandable, and narratively it definitely makes sense. And so once again, I know that was more of just like a recap, but again, I think it's important to highlight everyone's personalities in fights in these super intense situations. And now, after the fight, we had the sort of trial, I suppose. And let me just say, I know people have said it before, but oh my goodness, do I love Travis's roleplay with Ford in these serious moments. He is so good at taking that super clever, cunning leadership role and just going with it. It's such a treat to see him in this sort of a role. And then another thing that was sort of swept under the rug a little bit was Bo coming out as an expositor for the Cobalt Soul. Now, obviously, most of the Nine did not know she was a part of this, and after it was sort of let out of the bag, it wasn't really brought up again, besides with Nott later on. And then with the summoning of the demon with Ford, that wasn't brought up again either. There is so much that should have and needed to be talked about, but wasn't. Now, the obvious explanation for that is that everyone's a bit shell-shocked, I suppose, which is totally understandable, as a life-threatening battle had transpired and Avantika's life was quickly snuffed out, as the evidence was against her. And one point of interest with that whole trial that happened, Avantika seemed to have slipped up a little bit. You know, we saw her as this calculated captain, this cold, icy killer. But as everything was collapsing around her, she was telling very sloppy lies. Everything she was saying wasn't the truth. She maybe felt cornered, and she obviously felt betrayed, and maybe even heartbroken, since, you know, she even made mention of the romance. She felt that she was being used. It's possible she was just looking for pity, but maybe it wasn't. She basically lost everything at that point. Most of her crew had died. Vera was most likely almost dead, but still clutching a little bit. And it is sad in a way, seeing her character being killed off like this. You know, she was such a powerful villain that we got to see grow and to understand and learn about these past several episodes. You know, there is so much more to learn from this character. There's so many more interesting things to happen as they maybe find the other temples. They leave Avantika and betray her that way, and they come across her down the line. But sadly, we may not see these things at all. Or will we? Let's not forget that our friend Jimetti is most likely a revenant. And revenants are held to our plane of existence by a strong drive they failed to accomplish in their life. Now, considering how fanatical Avantika was, I would consider her drive to free Uketoa and get the power over the seas is a very, very strong desire that she did not complete. So, as sad as I am, and as sad as some of you other critters may be, I don't think we've seen the last of Avantika. And while the group didn't really decompress as much as a whole, there were a few conversations that happened that sort of shed a little light on new character developments that we haven't seen before. But then one small thing, as Bo, Caleb, and Nott were sort of discussing what had happened a little bit, Caleb was trying to decide on what they needed to do next, and what stuck out to me is that he wanted to go to Nicodranas specifically because he wanted Jester to see her mother again, which I thought was a really touching thing to think of, given everything that had just happened. He's still thinking about what Jester wants and what would make her happy. So just a very nice little thing that Caleb mentioned that I thought deserved a little bit of light. But I also have a new respect for Bo. You know, we've seen her as this very, you know, abrasive, tough individual that I very much appreciate. But there is something different about her this episode. There is a new sort of air of confidence, it seemed. Just the way that Marisha was role-playing her stance and her facial expressions, the way she held her shoulders back, she was just a different kind of confidence when she was sort of explaining to Nott what she's all about and what she's doing. She definitely seemed more mature and calculated, and as Caleb said, extremely educated. We already knew this. However, the rest of the Mighty Nine don't. They think she's just some, you know, punk girl that's, you know, just throwing punches. But behind that sort of wall is this highly educated, calculated beau. And lastly, of the conversations that we've had, which I think is probably the most important out of all of them, is the conversation that Ford and Jester had. She was trying to sort of figure out how Ford felt about everything that happened, and Ford said he felt relieved. And he expressed his desire to still find Vandarin, and Jester threw in there, well, if we find him, do you think he'll stop talking like him? Which leads us to believe that Ford's Texas accent is Vandarin's, and his little slip-ups is his normal voice. Now, how Jester knows this, I have no idea. Maybe one of you guys figured that out and you can let me know below, because I'm very interested to see how Jester sort of knew that, or maybe she was just guessing, and she guessed right. But that is a very, very interesting and important character development note, and I'm interested to see if maybe he'll become more comfortable with speaking in his normal voice, or maybe he'll explain why he uses Vandarin's voice instead of his own. It possibly goes more into the fact that he's not comfortable with being a half-orc, and he's trying to take on the personality traits of people that he respects, because he wants to be less like himself. He's afraid of himself, maybe. But then that was it. Those were really the only conversations that happened. The rest, everyone, I guess, sort of kept to themselves over the next few days as they left Darktoe. Which, again, makes sense. Everyone is sort of trying to figure things out for themselves. And I imagine in the next few episodes, when they have downtime again, these things will be brought up after they've had time to think about it. And I definitely think it needs to be talked about. And then towards the end of the episode, when they were down at the sea floor and Matt was sort of describing the scenery and stuff, there was a lot of imagery from Ford's dreams that he's had. Now, obviously that makes sense because his dreams took place in the sea and now they're in the sea, but perhaps those dreams showed him the future and now he's actually living them out. But what will also be interesting to see is with Avantika's death, if Ford has another dream in regards to that, what will Uketoa think, knowing that one of his chosen have been killed? But with the second half of the episode, it was just quite a stark contrast between the first half. You know, we have this very high intensity battle, and then a very nerve-wracking trial, and then a very somber, you know, melancholy second half of everyone trying to figure out what just happened. And then, of course, with the rain that followed after once they reached their destination of the shipwreck. Just very beautiful imagery and tones in this episode. And after that fight, I certainly hope the Mighty Nine don't get it too big of a head. Obviously, it went far better than most of us expected, and while they are extremely powerful at this point, they do still need to be careful. And with that, we are going to wrap up. But before I end the episode, there's a few things that I want to talk about, just about the channel in general. I have a few video ideas that I would like to do, that I'd like to share with you all and hear what you have to say. The first one would be this one I very much want to do because I want to involve you guys. I want to involve the community more in my videos. So one of the big things that I want to do is I want to do a live stream, either right after the episode, which might be a bit unlikely due to people probably wanting to sleep afterwards, since they sometimes go a little bit late depending on, you know, where you are in the US and Europe or wherever in the world. Or I would do it the following day, Friday evening, most likely. And basically in this live stream, I would just invite you guys onto the stream, and we would just discuss the episode and tell everyone our feelings on what had transpired. I think it'd be a very fun way to involve the community, because while we do have Talks Machina, that's mainly a discussion between the cast and the critters. This would mainly just be a discussion with the critters, and we just discuss the episode, talk about things we want to bring up, and I think it would be a lot of fun. But let me know what you guys think about that. And I also had another idea that maybe we would do bi-weekly or even monthly is a Critical Role-based game show. Now, I know there are, like, Jeopardy templates that we could possibly use, but ultimately I don't know what the game show would be just yet. But it was just an idea that I had that I think would be a lot of fun to involve the community with. And maybe eventually we could have, like, guest stars of the cast or maybe some prizes to give away, but that's sort of like a pipe dream. I think it would initially just be very fun to do as a community, just these little game shows every month or bi-weekly or something like that. So if you guys have ideas for that, please let me know. I would very much like to hear it. And now with all of that being said, we are going to end the episode. Let me know what you guys think down below. Do you think we're going to see Avantika again? What do you think the Mighty Nein is going to find down below in the shipwreck? And what other crazy antics are in store for the Mighty Nein? I hope you all have an absolutely wonderful rest of your weekend, and I will see you all next week.